I got the glasses reflection thing happening again because it's now it's my window.
No worries.
Let me just try and close it maybe. One thing I really admire about you is you've been walking the talk of racial equity longer than a lot of other people have been talking the talk. One thing I always enjoy is whenever you announce your new fellows, it's always exciting to just look at the thumbnails and see reflected back on the screen a panoply that looks like America and the world. And I don't see that in any other incubator. Why was that important to do? And then I'd love to hear about what it took to pull that off.
Yeah, so in some ways, I will say that has always been part of Echoing Green's DNA, and this predated me as an Echoing Green Fellow when I was selected in 1992. And I am always very clear about saying that, you know, I watched and noted that Echoing Green was really born and forged at the intersection of social justice and innovation. So it's always been there. But I think over time, you know, once I became staff and really got enmeshed in this community, it became, you know, sort of an interrogation for me about the possibility and promise of social innovation, right? So I think we all know, you know, this, that social innovation, you know, we talk about it as, you know, it's an approach to problem solving that really focuses on creating, you know, bold, audacious, positive social change. But I think, you know, almost 20 years ago, I started to think, well, what if you could actually use this powerful cross-sector alliance-based approach to end racial and class injustice? Like, what if you looked at sort of the key tools and strategies of the 20th century, community organizing, rights-based movements, advocacy, and add to your quiver social innovation? And I thought it was worth that interrogation. I believe all of those strategies help bring the country forward, but it's increasingly clear to me that in a moment when our problems are ever more complex, many of these problems are in fact existential, that these tools that so many of us relied on over the course of the 20th century are still necessary, but they're no longer sufficient. They're just not enough given what we have to confront and slay. And I just truly, I think, increasingly believe that social innovation had to get into the fight, and the army that we had to field had to look like the communities that we were working with. And so I think that leads you, that's the straight line between where we started and where we've come to today.
Not everyone would agree, though, that the leadership, even in social innovation, would necessarily have to come from the communities. There would other people who would say, let's get the smartest, most well-trained technocratic experts from Stanford Business School or somewhere else, and let's give them the resources because they have all of the skills and expertise to bring to these communities. It sounds like you would reject that point of view. Why is that?
I want everybody to be engaged, right? But I reject it in part. I think number one, and this is why, you know, one of the reasons why I think, you know, Brian Stevenson is so incredibly brilliant, because he sort of named and provided and gave cachet to this notion around proximity as a valuable asset and as real currency. And I think, you know, he articulated it perfectly. So sort of the lived experience of being proximate to an issue and community that allows you to have full faith and trust by those that you're working alongside of, I think is incredibly important. And when so much of the work around dismantling structural racism relates to building power, incumbent upon that process is ceding, sharing, turning over power to groups that have formerly been marginalized. And that's just the work. And so there's no way around it. You just got to go straight through it, and you've got to cede, you got to cede power. And that means you've got to have a diverse group of leaders of the communities being served to get the work done.
It also strikes me that if the premise of your work is we need to mobilize an army, as you described it, of social innovators to dismantle the systems of structural racism, one of the challenges you've identified is that one of those systems is the funding system. And so before anyone can dismantle a system, they are already constrained by a social sector funding system that is racist and that does withhold both money and control from the very people who you need to resource to liberate their potential. You recently took that to the next level of prominence by publishing an article in the Chronic Philanthropy on the racial funding gap can't continue. Tell us about what motivated you to do that research and what you learned from that work.
Yeah, so, you know, Echoing Green has spent, you know, the better part of a decade sort of annually looking at our applicant pool, usually from sort of semi-finalists through those we select, just sort of culling key trends and findings. And about a decade ago, started noticing, you know, we work really hard to find best-in-class talent, and by the time you're selected as an Echoing Green Fellow, you know, less than 1 or 2% of those who apply actually end up as fellows. Yet and still, we also started to notice that, you know, finalists and fellows were just hitting the wall in terms of funding disparities relative to their white counterparts. And, you know, in our way, we just sort of put it out there in a blog post annually, tried to show up at conferences and say, hey, guys, there's a problem here. But it was really interesting when we were approached by Bridgeban that was on its own racial equity journey and that had sort of, you know, research capabilities, you know, beyond Echoing Green's work as practitioners. So the ability to come together with, in fact, in some ways, the most pristine and perfect sample set you could imagine, right? So best in class leaders, unquestioned. These are the creme de la creme. And the fact that they were still having trouble raising money just sort of solidified and underscored, you know, research that others have done for years, whether it's Race Forward or APFI or First Nations Development Institute, Candid, so many others. We all sort of knew it, but in some ways it was sort of the crystallization through this perfect sample set of best in class leaders. And then I think the surprising thing really was the stark disparity in revenue differential between whites and blacks as it related to unrestricted net assets, right? So the findings that you alluded to is that, you know, black-led organizations in our portfolio raised 24% less in terms of revenue than their white-led counterparts in the 3 years following application to Echoing Green. But when you looked at unrestricted net assets, it was 76% smaller. And then, like, the punch in the face, you're like, wait a minute, when you looked at our Black Male Achievement Fellows, who were a group of Echoing Green Fellows that were focused on improving the life outcomes of men and boys of color in this country, the statistics were even worse. The Black-led organizations in the BMA Fellowship were raising 45% less in terms of revenue than their white-led counterparts, but 91% less in terms of unrestricted net assets. That gobsmacking, like, just shocking, shocking, shocking. And you've already mentioned this, Anthony, like, this all to us, you know, the light bulb moment that, you know, these disproportionate numbers are proxies for lack of trust. And you just see it time and time again. And I think, you know, that's the stat around unrestricted net assets and the level of disparity, I think, was really quite surprising and disheartening.
So what are you all and others, what are you all going to do? And what do you need the people watching this video to do to change that, so we don't have the same data when you do the research 10 years from now?
Yeah, right. So I think, you know, one thing is by doing conversations like this. So you can't fix what you don't know about, and you're not talking about, and what you can't measure. Well, we've measured it, and we're beginning to talk about it. And, you know, it's been wonderful for me as a nonprofit person to engage with funders in a way, honestly, I haven't had in 20 plus years of doing this, right? To be in communication, to be in conversation, and to have access with funders is just sort of a brand new experience for me, for us at Echoing Green. So we're trying to take full advantage of this moment. So part of it is just talking about it. And again, showing grace. And it's clear that some of it is lack of knowledge, so you provide knowledge, and then sort of truly the paralysis around, and I don't know what to do. So providing just steps on how you lean in and get it done. And from Echoing Green's perspective, you know, after Mr. Floyd was murdered, we were like, you know, we are an action-oriented community. Our you know, sort of our stance is always, so what are we going to do now? So just trying to think through some simple steps that we could provide in terms of a template or a roadmap for our colleagues across the social impact sector. One thing you do is start writing a check. Just move money, right? Just start moving money, invest and invest significantly in Black leaders and Black-led organizations. Networks like Echo and Green that has a lot of terrific leaders. I loved the giving guide that APFI did in partnership with Bridgeband recently. So there are extraordinary groups out there who deserve support, so support them now. I think another thing that, you know, we can start to think about is changing the way we support Black-led organizations, including the approach to capacity building. You know, Echoing Green has always talked about our leadership development approach. We talk about a leadership development through an equity frame, very much built on social determinants of health, sort of a holistic approach to leadership development that really centers the role of trauma, intergenerational trauma, and how you need to think through leadership development strategies, and recognizing that investment requires more than dollars. You've got to invest in your own learning. You've got to invest in all the wraparound supports for these leaders. And that's absolutely necessary. I think there's also sort of help building up the ecosystem, creating mechanisms for racial equity organizations, leaders of color to support one another, right? So how do you, as one of my colleagues says, create sort of these unapologetically Black spaces, BIPOC spaces where folks can be in community with one another, learning together, building power together, sharing the resources they need to maintain and continue to do this work. And then trying to be available to and thought partners with funders. You know, we often get the question of, you know, like, why should we, you know, invest in an intermediary like Echoing Green? And I presume you must get this question too, Anthony. And my goodness gracious, sort of the notion, the distance between the rooftops and the grassroots is a chasm. It's just a chasm. And I don't care how woke you are, or how woke you think you are, there are just some things that you are not in a position to do. So I think there's a real role for social impact intermediaries that are tethered to communities that have built deep trust, that are facile and responsive in a way that some of these funders cannot be, and that are just in the struggle with these organizations and make it worth the kind of investment that is needed in organizations like Echoing Green and NFF.
In what ways has this year changed either your sense of optimism about what's possible, or perhaps even elevated your sense of what is possible because of the way people have responded? What do you believe now that you didn't believe or know on March 1st this year?
I was a history and science major in college, and weirdly spent a lot of time studying pandemics, studying the bubonic plague, and sort of the premier scholar around the role of epidemics and pandemics in society, Frank Snowden, really talked about the transformative power of these sorts of events across. Right. And there's sort of there are two pathways, the fork in the road in moments like these, where there's opportunity for profound transformation. You know, it's out of, you know, the bubonic plague that we got many of the essential tenets of today's public health system, social distancing, wearing masks, but also terrible, you know, essentially hate crimes against the other because people were afraid of what had befallen them in their communities. And the question is, what road will we take? And this feels a moment made for social innovators who are comfortable with disruption, who understand the role of creative destruction, or thinking of new, better, best. So that gives me some hope. And things to hang on to as we try to reimagine so many systems that simply work for too few of us. So there's real opportunity to come out on the other side in a way that's more inclusive, more sustainable, and more just. It's going to take a lot of work. There's a tremendous amount of pain for far too many people to get there. But I think it's the work we have to do in the world at the moment.